Echo and Harper Audio present Points in Time by Paul Bowles, performed by Raphael Corkhill. A note before we begin. For additional notes on the text, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/points in time. 1. After half a day's voyage, they came to a large lake or marsh. No such place now exists, the lagoons being all to the north of the cape. South of it, the shore is either guarded by cliffs, steep slopes, or stony and sandy beaches. Nor is there any sign of such a lake having existed, and the sudden winter rains, which make every dry watercourse roar from bank to bank, are not of a character fit to cause floods, likely to be mistaken for a marsh or a lake. He dreamed of a hawk that hovered. A warning, the others said, and they went down to Asana, and the blind man at the entrance to the city raised his hand and spoke. Pay heed to the wind that moves above this place. The drums you hear are not of our people, nor are the hands that hit the skins. He saw the blind man's face and remembered the hawk. Behind the walls and higher were the hills, white and hard against the noonday sky. And they did not enter Asana, but turned southward over an empty plain and came to the bank of a river. Asana was destroyed. Only dust was there. Another road led from Tokolasida to Tingis. The first named place is doubtful. It might have been Mahila or Zarhun, but it was neither Amargo nor Xarferaun. The stones of Tokolosida are there in the shadows below the cliff. The Moorish Sultan, who had suffered at Sierra Morena such a defeat by the Spaniards that for several days the victors used no other fuel than the pikes, lances, and arrows of their fallen enemies, answered his captors with great dignity that he had lately read the Book of Paul's Epistles, which he liked so much that were he to choose another faith, it should be Christianity. But for his part, Nazarenes have the minds of small children. He thought every man should die in the religion into which he was born, and this will probably not get through into those pork-nourished brains. The only fault I find with Paul is that he deserted Judaism, he told them, smiling. The old cemetery by the grottos has been despoiled. To our great grief, they have converted it into plowed land. And by the seven Sepharim and the seven heavens, by the 12 rows, by the bread and the salt, by the name and the sacrifice, we swear that justice shall be made to prevail. A few can remember that summer. The sun's breath shriveled what it touched. No one went out, for there was fever in the lower city. They say he had a walled-in garden where he walked at sunset. It could have been his prison, save that he was free, and with the leisure to invent the perils that beset him from within. Shall the pillar of the law be shattered, and the edifice laid with the dust, the Mishnah desecrated and trodden underfoot? With the seven categories of the just, may his part and lot remain. No one went out. We waited in our darkened rooms, and with every breath of wind that clicked the blinds, we shuddered. May those destroyed by fever rest in Eden, and their dwelling be under the tree of life. 2. In the course of his travels in Portugal, Fra Andrea of Spoleto had met a man for whom he felt great sympathy, and the man happened to be a Muslim. Heretofore, he had not known anyone professing that faith, none having chanced to visit the Franciscan monastery where he had lived, and he was amazed, after an hour's talk with this Moroccan gentleman, to find him not only wholly conversant with Christian doctrine, but actually in accord with certain of its tenets. They saw one another often during that year. As a result of their growing friendship, Si Musa conceived the idea of inviting Fra Andrea to Fez in order to set up a small Franciscan mission there. Initially, the concept struck the monk as purely a fantasy and quite unrealizable. Then Si Musa let fall the information that his wife was the sister of King Mohammed VIII, who at that time ruled Morocco from Fez. As you know, His Majesty has had ample opportunity to study the works of the Christians, Si Musa remarked with a wry smile. Fra Andrea nodded. He understood that his friend was referring to the unfortunate king's long incarceration by the Portuguese. Solitude and study can make a man tolerant, you know, he went on. It would give him great pleasure to have you and your friends in Fez so that the public could see for itself that not all infidels are savages. Here Fra Andrea guffawed. Si Musa smiled politely, not understanding the reason for his mirth. It was this very ingenuousness in the Moroccan which delighted the monk, and which doubtless was instrumental in persuading him to accept his unlikely suggestion. 3 years later, Fra Andrea arrived in Fez, along with Fra Antonio and Fra Giacomo, two other Franciscans who had gone because they considered it their duty to be on hand in Fez, where they might be able to intercede on behalf of Christian hostages being held for ransom. Fra Andrea was looking forward particularly to having religious discussions with the several Muslim intellectuals to whom Si Musa had given him letters of introduction. From the moment of their arrival, everything went wrong for the three. When Fra Andrea tried to find the men to whom he had the notes, he discovered that they were all mysteriously absent from Fez. The old palace near the Funduk Nejerin, which Si Musa had assured him would be put at his disposal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.